And like today, would you please join me in a moment of silence? And the pledge to our flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. All right. Let's open with a positive of Carroll. Gentlemen?
Positively Carroll. Well, we positively got through the holidays, and that's probably a good thing, although I got to attach a negative to it, and I'm going to get on my public safety hat and take off my commissioner hat for a minute, or maybe put both of them on. We continue to see an increase in auto accidents in the county, and certainly we've seen some tragedies through the holidays as a result of that. I don't know what you attribute it to, whether it's unsafe conditions, weather. There's always that distracting driving thing that comes up. So I would just ask, trying to bring it back more positive, that folks be mindful of our roadways, especially with the fact that we may be challenged tomorrow or tonight with some inclement weather. And it just seems like that's on the uptick, and that's troubling to me. So I would ask that everybody perhaps slow down. And I'm not putting any fault on anyone, but just as a reminder, there is that thing out there about not talking on your phone or texting when you're driving. And I would ask that perhaps we continue to go by the rules when it comes to driving on our roadways. So other than that, I'd like to, hopefully express a Happy New Year to everyone. Hopefully everyone came through the holidays relatively unscathed. So had a great legislative breakfast this morning. Three of us were there getting the lowdown on what we are going to be anticipating coming up here in the next 3 months in Annapolis. So giddy with excitement over that, got to tell you. So,
if you're not, they say Happy New Year. Hope everyone has a very prosperous and happy New Year coming. Again, Commissioner Wance is coming up at the legislative breakfast. Hoping legislators from Carroll County have a great session down in Annapolis. Hope they bring us some additional money back to Carroll County, hopefully for schools or anything else. Carroll kind of money it is, but could use some extra money from the state.
Just money.
Any kind of money is good for us. And have a great New Year.
He's optimistic.
The green kind.
Happy New Year.
Okay, I'm having a little chest pain now. I'll be up here.
Excuse me, Officer Wance. You have a
okay. Echo that. Happy New Year, and I think 2017 is going to be good for Carroll County. I am optimistic on that, and I really feel with our legislative dinners, breakfast we've had in the last few days, we're going to have a good year. Keep in mind today we do have amendments to the 2014 Water and Sewer Master Plan, and it will be a hearing today. And if anybody's here for the hearing, please sign in the back. There's a sign-in sheet located there, and this is just to say that you have attended the hearing if you're here for that. Okay, let's move right along. We have a briefing decision, possible discussion, possible decision, request for a grant application for the Carroll County Outdoor School Earth Day Environmental Education. We have Ms. Gail Ingalls, Chief Bureau of Resource Management, and Colleen Enzer, Watershed Grants Analyst, with us. And welcome.
Good morning, and Happy New Year. We want to kick off the new year by applying for a couple of grants through the Chesapeake Bay Trust. And the first one that we'll be talking with you today is a mini grant for the Carroll County Outdoor School Earth Day, which we will be celebrating on April the 26th at the Farm Museum, and Colleen will tell you a little bit more about that.
The Department of Land and Resource Management, Bureau of Resource Management, is seeking $5,000 from the Chesapeake Bay Trust mini grant program. The funds will be used to provide restoration and maintenance of a bioretention facility and plant trees during an Earth Day event with the Carroll County Outdoor School at the Farm Museum on April 26th. A second group of students will return on September 21st to replant at the facility and perform maintenance activities. This project will assist the county with meeting the requirements established by the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination Systems Permit and will provide the students with a better understanding of the effectiveness of various best management practices installed at the Farm Museum.
Okay. Any questions?
I see the county match is $7,941. I'm assuming that's already in our budget, so there's no additional funds necessary.
Yes.
Okay. And this is a recurring grant, isn't it? And we've done this.
We have not applied for this particular grant for Earth Day as of yet. We've applied for several projects in the Farm Museum for other elements of the site work that we were doing out there, but this particular one related to Earth Day and the school kids is the first time we've applied.
Okay. Because I know there's been some similar things, mm-hmm. but it's never been in this structure, I guess, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So I'll jump on Commissioner Frazier's question, take it a little step further. Why is the county match exceed what the grant request is for? Is there what are we doing extra that we need that extra amount there?
Sure. So it's actually a mini grant program, so the maximum we can apply for is $5,000.
Okay.
So.
Okay, that answers the question.
Yeah.
I move the Board of Commissioners approve the submittal of the application for the mini grant program for the K-12 for environmental education.
Second.
Second. Moved and second. All in favor?
Discussion.
Question. Are any environmental groups being brought in to teach anything like Sierra Club or Water Keepers or anything like that? Or are we doing this on our own?
We're doing this on our own.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. But it's through the outdoor school, right?
We've partnered with them for several years, and so we've decided that the Farm Museum is a nice location to meet with the students each year and celebrate Earth Day. And this year is the first time we're going to try to incorporate a fall event as well. As we mentioned, in September, we're going to bring a group of students back to maintain the facility.
Just so the public and my fellow commissioners know why I asked that question, I firmly believe that some environmental groups have crossed the line. They are marketing themselves as environmental groups, but in fact, they are left-wing political advocacy groups masquerading as environmental groups, and some of them I don't believe should be getting a voice inside of our school system.
Fair enough. I guess the outdoor school, though, will be involved with
yes.
assisting in the education portion of this.
Correct.
Okay. Okay. Motion is made and second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Okay, move on to number two.
Okay, we're also going to be presenting to the Chesapeake Bay Trust another application for a mini grant for the walking trail educational signage at the Westminster Community Pond. And Colleen will talk a little bit about that.
So this one might be familiar as well. We did pursue another similar grant opportunity for $5,000 through their outreach and restoration mini grant. We weren't selected for that one because it was very competitive, but this is another opportunity for us to pursue funding, and they are interested in the program. So this is the mini grant for community engagement. The Department of Land and Resource Management, Bureau of Resource Management, is seeking $5,000 from the Chesapeake Bay Trust Community Engagement mini grant. And this funding will support the purchase and installation of 4 signs to be placed along the walking trail at the newly renovated Westminster Community Pond. The total cost of the signs will be $7,200. The Bureau of Resource Management, in partnership with the Department of Recreation and Parks, will use this signage to raise awareness about the pond's impact on the quality of local water sources. The addition of these signs will encourage Carroll County residents to become stewards of the local watersheds and allow them to gain a better understanding of stormwater management and the Forest Conservation Act.
How large are these signs?
They're similar to other like park signs, so I'm not sure of the exact measurements offhand.
That's a very good question.
Yeah.
I think they're at least 3x2.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they're waterproof where they don't have to be maintained or replaced. They're ones that you see like in the Civil War areas where they're clear coated And basically, they're going to set on a concrete plank then, a platform.
The Farm Museum has used similar signage at their facility as well.
Educational signs.
Yes.
So the information on these signs, is this going to be political information or factual information?
Factual.
The history, we also had a Boy Scout troop that was involved in a project, so they also designed one of the signs, one of the four signs that was located there.
Okay, do we have factual data about the quality impact the pond has on?
Yes.
Okay, we'll make sure that it's fact-based.
Yep.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. One of the signs actually is going to talk about the history of the pond itself, which we worked with Recreation and Parks to come up, they came up with the language for that sign. Another sign is going to refer to the stormwater facility itself and the design of that and the treatment related to that. Forest conservation will be on another sign, which will talk about the forest conservation law, and it will overlook the area that was planted for the project for the forest conservation. And then another sign will talk about the Eagle Scout project in the wetlands that was done out there by Eagle Scout. And he actually designed the sign himself for that project. So that's the signage that we're looking at putting at the farm, at the community pond.
I'm sensitive to this today because I sat for 4 hours last night in testimonies of the Monocacy River Advisory Board. And, you know, people are just saying things that aren't true. You know what I mean? They're just saying things, and it usually falls in the realm of more is better, but more is better is not a rubric for decision-making. It's a formula for bankruptcy. And just want to be careful of what we put on these signs. You know, people say to me, are you against green? Are you anti? No, I'm pro-green, but just like being an investor, you can have good investments and bad investments. You can have good green, and you can have bad green investments. And the ingredient that's missing from the formula is people think as soon as they put a label of green or sustainability on something, like that it's good. We've got to be directing our energy in ways that are effective. And so much of what I saw in a 4.5-hour public hearing yesterday was just false. So I just want to make sure that we're promulgating the correct information to our citizens and children. Thank you for your work.
I will echo, I do have concern about that project. I'm not sure we can speak later, but I heard some good things could happen from this, could be detrimental to us. So.
Thank you.
Okay, so here comes a commercial. I did a Keeping It Real. Tune in to channel, whatever. Anyway, I did one of my Keeping It Real episodes on this particular project.
Yes.
And I can assure you that the signage that's out there will be spot on because we covered everything that you just said was going to be on that signage that day in about 15 minutes. And help me out.
Chris Hine
was unbelievably knowledgeable of every aspect of that project. So I have absolutely no doubt that those signs will be spot on with the message that needs to be there.
Well, and just so you know, his son, Peter, was actually the Boy Scout, Eagle
right.
Scout project.
Yeah.
So he's the one that designed the sign for the Eagle Scouts.
And it is interesting because a lot of folks look at that pond and think, well, it's just a pond. But, you know, the stormwater that it mitigates there and the way that it does is unbelievable. Folks need to know a little bit more about that
pond.
How
many acres does that mitigate?
Pond itself, 3 acres.
3 acres, but the area, the watershed area that it affects?
110, I think is what it was.
Sizable amount.
Yeah, it is. It is. There's more to it than just a pond that has geese crap around it. Can I say crap? Tim, can I say? Okay.
As a matter of discernment, you're allowed to say crapola.
Crapola. Okay.
Okay.
I didn't see a flag, so I just, you know.
And your bird is right, with a little pinky up in the air and your glass of Perrier while you say crapola.
Okay, sorry about that. I kind of went off on it.
Okay, I move that the Board of Commissioners approve the submittal of the application for the mini-grant program for the community engagement.
And I'll second that. Now, just made and second. Any additional questions? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay. Public comment will be taking during the public hearing here. Westminster Water and Sewer Plan, and here said earlier, if you haven't signed in, please do.
Don't see any public here, Commissioner.
Phil Hager, Director of Planning and Zoning, and Andrea Gerhart, Comprehensive Planner.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Commissioners. Andrea and I are before you today to assist in conducting a hearing on proposed amendments to the Water and Sewer Plan. In accordance with all the required county processes and also pursuant to state law, we are conducting this hearing in the usual manner that it's done. So what we'll do is have Andrea do a short presentation, at the conclusion of which it would be appropriate to convene the hearing and see if there's anyone who wishes to testify.
Good morning. So this is just a reminder to let you know that we do this water and sewer master plan on behalf of all the municipalities. So as far as the legal requirements, this hearing today was duly advertised in the Carroll County Times on December 22nd and December 29th. So this is, as always, just wanted to let you know and show you what our public hearing notice looked like. And as you have seen, I believe twice at this point, but we're just going to go through them very quickly again. Here's our water amendments. Water amendments affect the city of Tawnytown and the city of Westminster. The city of Tawnytown, this here is for a 20.44-acre parcel. This is for the Evapco expansion, going from the long-range planning to priority. This is for a 140,000-square-foot expansion. And this is for an approximate 5,850 gallons per day that would be added to the service area. Here's for the city of Westminster. And once again, this is for the Penguin Random House to expand it to the portion of the property from the Westminster Mission property when it was consolidated to the Penguin Random House that was in the no plan service to go into the existing final planning. It's approximately 7 acres. So this would only be 125 gallons per day because this expansion would be for a warehouse that would only consist of one restroom. Just wanted to give you once again just a zoomed in area. This is what this property currently looks like in our service area, and for after this amendment, it would be fully encapsulated in blue. This here would be the amendments to our Table 16, which is the projected water supply. This only consists of the amendment to the yellow portion, which is Tawnytown, which is going to include that 5,850 gallons. The reason that we did not include an amendment to both the, to the Westminster section is because it's only the 125 gallons. In this table, with Westminster being such a large service area, it would not show up onto this table. For sewer, we have amendments to three different service areas. It's to the Freedom service area, Tawnytown, and also Westminster. Freedom, it is to include the rest of this property, and I will do a zoomed-in portion. So it is to include the rest of this property here. This was initiated by a property owner who, and originally in your first staff report, it did say that this was a property currently going through the development review process. This has since been corrected. This amendment is necessary for the property owner to begin the development review process. So the county does a buildable land inventory, and so this property currently at the beginning, the very top, the buildable land inventory said that this property could have 13 lots on it. The property owner, through their site plan that they would like to put forward through a subdivision plan, would have 15 lots. So therefore, 500 gallons would be added to the service area. So because of that, we would only be adding 500 because the rest of the gallonage would already be added into the, is already calculated into our demand.
Before you leave Freedom.
Yes.
I may have something mixed up in my mind here, but I know we talked about reallocating reserve capacity and Freedom from septic changeovers to new construction. Is that in this plan?
That is not part of this discussion. That is for the Freedom Comprehensive Plan.
Yes, that is something that's separate.
So why wouldn't that be in the Water and Sewer Master Plan?
The first thing that has to happen is that it has to go through the Freedom Community Comprehensive Plan first. That kind of sets the stage, and then it's going to go through with the triennial update. So it first has to happen in a master plan first, okay. And then the...
Somebody just asked you one question about it, since we are on Freedom Septic. Because
sure.
Somebody asked me this question a while back, and I couldn't answer the question. Does allocating the reserve capacity that's currently reserved for septic conversions in Freedom, will that affect the amount of reserve that we potentially have for industrial commercial at some point? Could it? Would it likely to?
What we did for the Freedom conversation is that we did it for reallocating for residential. Anything that was commercial industrial, that portion stayed within that reserve.
So do we still have, what kind of reserve capacity do we have for additional industrial commercial growth in Freedom right now?
If it is currently on septic,
No. If tomorrow Microsoft wanted to build a plant in Freedom, what kind of reserve capacity do we have for water and sewer in Freedom right now?
Well, that's something we can definitely find out for you.
You had that on a chart, I believe, for the Planning Commission, if I remember right, was separate in there, and I think this was addressed.
I just don't remember, Dick.
It was in there, I think, and they had commercial, industrial, and then residential separate on that. I don't remember the numbers either, but...
Yeah, in the ways of... we never took anything that was for a commercial industrial away from what is allocated for commercial industrial. If anything, we took the septic systems that are being currently allocated for residential and made it available to commercial industrial.
Because when these plans are drawn up, I know for me with the City of Westminster, they put a certain amount aside for residential, a certain amount aside for industrial, a certain amount aside for commercial. And if you're going to use reserve for residential, you take it from a residential side, it doesn't affect commercial or industrial.
Correct.
And if there's commercial industrial properties that are undeveloped that are in the Freedom area that are currently part of the water and sewer plan, and they're already in the existing service areas, but they're undeveloped, the capacity for that development is already programmed into all of the capacities based upon the size of the property.
Now, for industrial, what do you assume, 50%? For a high user would be like medical, laboratory, do you assume a 50%? Mix. I just want to make sure our reserves are enough for industrial commercial there.
The way that we do it is we do 800 gallons per acre for industrial, and that we would also do 700 gallons per acre for commercial.
Right, but that's a nominal number. It could be less, it could be more.
Absolutely, but throughout the service area, it tends to balance itself out. So for some places, it could be a lot less, and some places it could be a lot more, but throughout the service area, it does tend to balance itself out.
Thank you.
And for the Tawny Town and Westminster both for sewer, it does mirror exactly the water. So this, once again, is the Evapco for the 5,850 gallons for their expansion, and then also for Westminster for the 125 gallons. And once again, just wanted to give you a more zoomed-in look. Tawny Town, also for their Table 27, wanted to also include the 5850 number for the expansion also on this table as well. We went ahead and sent this to our various agencies, as we always do. We did receive a comment from Land and Resource Management, and they did provide us the comments clarifying that the property in Freedom is not yet within the development review process, as we originally had thought. So we did note that within the new staff report that this amendment is necessary in order for the property to submit a plan for subdivision. The Westminster Planning Commission certified that these amendments were consistent with their plan on November 17th, and Tawny Town certified that these amendments were consistent with their plan on December 19th. And our Planning Commission certified that these amendments were consistent on both November 15th and December 20th to the Carroll County Master Plan. Are there any additional questions that I can help answer?
Andrew, you go. You don't have to go back. Well, maybe you do. To the chart that showed that Tawnytown wanted it to be shown on there 50-50. Just explain that again.
Sure.
On that table, so that we're clear on that.
Sure.
Why they wanted to show that, what
sure.
the purpose of that is.
So, in here, in other demand, because this is a industrial property, we have to include, let me explain real quick. This is our residential demand, and here's other. So this is where commercial and industrial demand would be located. And so here's our priority. This is where this 5,850 gallons would be. So we are now adding this 5,850 gallons to this number. So this is where the additional new demand would be added to. So that's why I have it highlighted in here, because this is, in this table, this is the only thing that's being affected by this amendment.
Right. Okay.
So it is added both here as well as here to these numbers.
Okay. So the point one?
It's 0.178.
That already reflects that additional 5,000 and some whatever
yes.
gallons. Okay. Okay.
And so it also was added to the total demand here as well.
Right. Okay.
And that also just decided to do it that way also to make it easier for MD to focus on that as well.
Right. And the city of Tawnytown is good with the fact that you threw it in this manner, correct? I mean,
They actually are the ones who brought the amendment forward.
Okay.
So it is a requirement by MDE for us to include this table in our water and sewer master plan.
Okay.
This is how they want us to show all of our data.
Got it. Okay.
So this is what they go to. Yes.
Okay. Very good.
Any other questions from the board? At this point, this is a fall 2016 amendments to the 2014 water and sewer master plan. Mr. Burke, do you need to open up for comment?
Is there anyone who has any public comment on this matter? Mr. President, it appears we have no comments on this matter.
Okay. We'll hear the staff recommendation on this.
So, yeah, we're to that point now, right? No comments. And
no comments.
Do we have to open and close the hearing just to make it official, or are we just, you know... think
well,
we are.
Close
we are.
The
close it.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll make the motion that we close the public hearing portion of the. It's in there.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah.
I don't think
it is. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Do I sense a little sarcasm there, Ms. Windham? Oh, I see it. I move the board authorize this item to proceed to public hearing. And during
no.
state, we already did that.
No.
The other page.
No.
Oh, I'm on the other page.
No, I'll do it, Steve. I move that the board close this hearing and keep the record open for a period of not less than 10 days prior to considering a motion for adoption.
Thank you.
We hear a second.
Second.
Hey, I'm not even going to second it because I can't see.
Any other questions? If not, the motion has been made and second.
So
all
times.
In favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Well,
aye. You.
Thank you, Commissioner.
That was
high. Okay. Unanimous. Boy, that was tough.
Don't ever tell anybody you can't see when you're an elected official. just leave yourself open.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Windows wide open.
It's a new year. I mean, I might as well get right out of the gate, right? Let's go.
Okay, we need to move ahead to a briefing decision, a discussion decision on the bid approval for tire recycling. And Mr. Myers, I believe you're up.
Mike Myers. Chief Bureau of Purchasing.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Our first bid approval today is for the removal and disposal of scrap tires from the northern landfill. Citizens have the opportunity to discard scrap tires up to a certain size at the northern landfill for a fee. We then contract with a company to come in and haul those tires out and dispose of them. So we went out to bid. We got one bidder, and that's Austin Contracting, and they are willing to remove these tires at $148 per ton.
So we're going to the highest bidder?
Yes.
What are we doing?
Fierce competition.
I'm sorry.
Where are they going? What are we doing with them?
These will be shredded.
They have shredder equipment, so.
For playground, whatever.
Various possible uses at that point, yes.
Wow. Now, we collect a fee for tire disposal.
Yes, we currently charge $150 per ton.
Per ton?
We raised that rate last spring for the current fiscal year from $125 per ton to the current $150 because we knew the market was about to take a dramatic shift. The Harford County Waste Energy Facility closed last spring, mm-hmm. and that was the major location for tires in the state of Maryland to go to. With the closure of that, the market shifted, and this is a result of that.
Okay. And 552 tons.
Lion's share of that 552 was the agricultural tire cleanup. Okay.
And we were reimbursed for this.
We were,
for yes. That, so. Okay.
The staff motion on this is interesting, the way it's worded. Before we, I know this is going to go through, but it says, I move that the Board of Commissioners, I move that the Board of Commissioners concur with the award and authorize the Bureau of Purchasing to move forward to obtain legally sufficient contract documents for signing. Is there a reason it's worded that way, as opposed to say to obtain legally sufficient contracts and exit and go ahead and make the award or sign? It sounds like we're authorizing just to get the legally sufficient contracts as opposed to actually authorizing you to.
Yeah, that probably could have been worded a little bit better.
Okay. Just making sure I didn't miss something there. Okay.
You want to put it in the form of a motion?
Okay. I move that the Board of Commissioners concur with the award, authorize real purchasing to move forward, obtain and execute legally sufficient contract documents for signing by Jeff Castonguay, Director of Department of Public Works.
Second.
Motion. Any questions? Any further questions on tire recycling?
No.
Removal? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous? Thank you.
Thank you.
I suppose we get in the tree swing business and sell them instead. Huh?
Mike, I guess you're still on. For the next part here, this is the briefing discussion decision on the removal and replacement of three heat pumps at the Tawingtown Branch Library. Introduce everybody here.
Yeah, we got Scott Moser with the Deputy Director of Department of Public Works and Doug Lindsay with the Bureau Chief of the Bureau of Facilities. Our second bid award today is for the removal and the installation of three new heat pumps at the Tawingtown Library. Went out to bid, received two bids, and the lowest bidder was Sagamore Mechanical Services in the amount of $51,893.
How old are the three heat pumps?
They're put in 1988.
All three of them?
All three.
Okay, so they're end of life. Well, I've got 30 years out of them.
You got a lot of them.
That's pretty remarkable.
That's good, yeah.
They're taken care of well.
And I'm sure the new ones would be much more efficient.
Correct.
Well, we put the bid out. Did we put a bid out asking for a specific SEER rating or just for efficiency?
Both.
What is the SEER rating that we're looking for?
Actually, it was
12.
12
Sears. 12 Sears low.
Yeah.
Sure. 12.
Very good units.
They're running like 18 Sears now, I think, aren't they?
I don't know.
Oh, but these are commercial grid.
Yeah.
Okay, got it. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the comment was that the commercial units don't achieve the 18 SEER ratings we see in residential. Now, what is the warranty we're getting on these?
Warranty on these is
just
5 years.
5 year compressor.
Yeah.
1 year parts and labor.
Mm-hmm. Come to the mic so that we just make it official.
Yeah. And please. Name, please.
With the facility supervisor. Mm-hmm. The warranty would be on the compressor is 5 years, 1 year parts and labor for Sagamore to come in. After 1 year's up, it's under our facilities to take care of the equipment. So roughly, like I say, 5 years parts.
Five years parts and compressor.
And three, 12 years.
So you're saying for commercial heat pump 12 series, very efficient.
Yes. Yep. It's going to be a York unit. I don't know if you guys are familiar with brands.
Right.
Top quality. And that's what we expect out. Mm-hmm.
How many tons are these
units? The one's 15, the other one's 7.5, and a 3.5.
Okay, so that's not bad. No, are we replacing the air handlers or just the heat pumps?
Air handlers.
So air handlers and heat pumps.
Yeah.
So that's a pretty good price then for that much.
Modifying the ductwork, new thermostats, new disconnects,
whole nine
yards. Okay. And you'll see going forward, we're trying to standardize what we're putting in each building. The guys maintaining it, they have the parts handy, and we can just replace things or fix things as we go along instead of ordering parts and waiting for things to be delivered.
In fact, we got 29 years out of the last ones. Is amazing. I got 26 years of mine. I thought that was a world's record. But I've had to go through a few compressors.
Well, they said they actually got to the point where they're making parts to make these things continue to run at this point.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
That's unique.
All right, I move the Board of Commissioners concur with this decision and an authorized purchasing move forward to purchase these three heat pumps for the Tawny Town Library in the amount of $51,893.
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Have any other questions? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Doug.
Yes.
I saw that the merry-go-round disappeared yesterday, and it reminded me when next time I saw you to say, thanks again. I mean, that was, I heard a ton of comments on that display out there. I got to tell you, you guys did a yeoman's job out there.
Yeah, that was good.
I made a special trip up with my wife just to show it to her.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, it's going to rotate next year, right?
We'll see what we can do.
That would be great. I'd also like to see, since we had music over Christmas, you know, have the fountain dancing to music.
It'd be ice.
Nice talking to you, Doug.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, we move up for a briefing, discussion, possible decision, a need for additional vehicles.
Good morning.
With us we have Jeff Castonguay, Director of Public Works, Jeff Topper, Deputy Director of Public Works, and Will Rosenberg, Carroll Transit Service.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Morning.
Okay, we do have a problem that we are trying to address regarding the transit program, in that we have an order in with the state, as you know, for four vehicles for fiscal 14 that have yet to come, six vehicles for fiscal 15, and six more from fiscal 17, all of which are in the queue. In fact, MTA is meeting with the vendor today to determine what that schedule is, when buses would be expected to come. We know that it's probably going to be out there months, could be 9 months to a year before those vehicles start coming into us. In the meantime, we have a fleet that has right now at least 40%+ of the vehicles are over 200,000 miles over 6 years. We have a few more of the buses that are rapidly approaching the 200,000 mile mark, which means we're close to half of our fleet being in need of constant repair. We're trying to keep up with preventive maintenance. When we bring the vehicles in for preventive maintenance, many times other things are being found, which makes the preventive maintenance time lengthen out. As those buses are not in service, it makes it difficult to keep the service in place. So what we're trying to do is keep the routes going, and keep the preventive maintenance at the established MTA amount of 80% compliance, so that we are doing the proper preventive maintenance on time. What we are thinking about is to try to put some buses in place now, maybe through a lease option, where Buffer would be buying some buses, and we would lease from them.
Going out for procurement.
And what we'd like to do is just have that option to go forward with procurement, with trying to put a plan in place now to get these additional buses. Maybe you want to speak a little bit more.
Yeah, what we're looking at is some of the buses that we will be receiving hopefully sometime in calendar 17, but there's been some estimates going to early 18. But again, we don't know the schedule as of to date. Some of the buses that we will be receiving are not to, it's not going to one-for-one replacement. This is to add on additional services, additional lines, some other programs that we've been, that have been on the books for Carroll County Transit System now for multiple years. These buses are going to help facilitate that. So these aren't going to be a one-for-one replacements, which then also leaves us with a spare ratio. Basically, so no spares.
Before you go to the spare ratio, I know my fellow commissioners got to be having the same questions here. We have buses we've ordered 2 years, 2.5 years ago, we haven't received yet.
That's correct. 3 years ago, actually.
3 years ago, we haven't received. So why are we just sitting back waiting? Why haven't we said we're going to do a new procurement, a director procurement? Why don't we go to FR Conversions and ask them to build them for us? Why do we not put deadlines on deliveries? If you can't deliver within so many months, then don't bid? Why are we in this position?
It's not our procurement process. It's the state procurement process. And they've been tied up in legal matters for several years, legal challenges to their procurement.
Okay. Okay, fair enough.
MTA, FTA required.
This is state money that we're using?
State and federal.
Is the nature of the state money such that if we said, look, you guys can't deliver, so we're going to go ahead and order it through our own procurement process, and you can go ahead and write us a check? No?
Unfortunately, we're not allowed.
You can't do that.
We can spend our own money, county money, spend their money.
So I want the public to see. So based on what I think you just told me is 3 years ago we ordered buses, and thanks to the tremendous effectiveness of government, the state government, in procuring these vehicles, we still don't have deliveries. That's got to be the only time in history somebody's ordered a vehicle and not gotten them 3 years later. What a mess.
It was part of the process has happened. It's been the bids have been contested. And when the bids are contested, there's a process has to go through in order to have the bidders and have to go through the legal processes. So that's unfortunately that is the landscape we've had to look at now for the last few years, and it's been unfortunate. And now it seems like we finally turned the corner on this process, and at least now some of these buses would be constructed. But again, what we're running into is, again, we're in the same queue as everybody else in the state.
So let me ask you this. There's got to be a process, though, for emergencies, like in medical. And in the medical industry, if you have an emergency, you can say stat, in which case you get what you need right away. If we had only one ADA bus and it got wrecked, there would be some process for buying a new one stat. Isn't there a way that we can say, we've waited long enough, we want them stat, so we're going to bypass conventional procurement processes?
At that point, that would be funds, as Roberta mentioned, that will be funding by the commissioners from our county money, and then it would be a county-owned bus.
These are state funds, right?
Right. For these buses, because of the grant funding that's attached to each, we have multiple grants that fund these buses. And so that's why we have to follow the MTA and FTA requirements.
So why don't we go to the governor's office and say, get us our money. We need some buses. Our ability to provide our services.
We'll be there with every other county.
Exactly. All the jurisdictions are in this position.
So how much? Well, I mean, if I can shed a little light here, we've done that.
Basically, we
and
have.
We stand in line
with everyone else
to get to Pete, to get to the governor.
Yes.
And they're hearing the message across the state. And evidently, and Will, you might have a little bit, I don't know, any of you might have a little bit of knowledge as to why these contracts have been held up. I mean, there's been some.
So as Mr. Castonguay indicated, they went out to procurement. They were awarded procurement. However, there was a challenge to the bid, and then the bid was held up in both internal processes for bid arbitration and then into legal processes for bid arbitration. They finally awarded the bid to a vendor. As Mr. Topper indicated, the pre-bill conference for that, the State Public Works approved that bid in early December.
Yes.
And the pre-bid meeting is today, I believe, or coming up shortly, I think it's today. And then the state will decide how these 200-plus buses are allocated county by county or jurisdiction by jurisdiction and where we fall on the bid line. And then the vendor will indicate to the state when they can get around, when they can allocate building them on the timeline, but there are 200-plus buses to be.
When we say we're in line with the governor's office, I mean, what does that mean? I mean, my request would be, hey, just, Mr. Governor, since you guys can't deliver, just order SHA, MTA to just give us a check and we'll get them ourselves. That's a letter yes to write.
Well, but it,
I brought this up at our transportation meeting with Secretary Paul and his staff.
Ron,
there you go, Ron. Paul, someone. Secretary Ron, there you go. And we were told then that this was going to come about this year. I told, we know we've waited for 16 buses since for 3 years and so forth. They're doing everything they can to expedite the process. I was told at the time that we'd have them within 6 to 8 months. Now that was a while ago. Maybe it's not going to work out that way, but I mean that's just the way it is.
And
it's not just us; it's everybody.
It could be another year.
What we run into is there's very limited vendors that can make, that have the ability to make the variety of buses, everything from just a small conversion van. You know, these vendors do everything from small conversion vans up to the full size buses that you see running across, you know, some of your major cities. So there's only a few vendors out there in the U.S. that can win this. So when one wins the entire contract, it's typical that usually it's some part of it's being contested. This one just happened to go into further steps, which resulted in further delays. The other thing we do face is on top of getting the buses, again, because we're trying to get so many across the state at the same time, is we have to put in that factor that chassis may not be available. Again, they're going to say Ford is the chassis that they're putting our type buses on, and they have to make, you know, 10,000 of them for everybody to meet the need in the state. They may only get, it depends on how quick Ford can get them the chassis, how many they have in their yard, and then how many they can continue to get from Ford at whatever production rate that they have. Those are things that we will run into. This is hence the reason why we're, you know, here today to talk about leasing some buses that we have some funding that we can utilize that Jeff will go into some details on in order to go out for bid, get some buses that we can lease that for short term, you know, for the leasing prices will be covered by these funds that we do have currently, and have these buses in the future, so this way we have buses that ongoing we can use for spare ratios, we can use for any type of services, whether it's veterans or any of the other trailblazer. We can then determine what we want to do with those buses because they will be owned and operated by the county. Then it would also allow us the ability in the future, if we want to continue on with these buses, is to have a portion of this fleet, so if another situation like this happens in the future, at least we have some control over a portion of the fleet, that we do have this ability, like Commissioner Rothschild mentioned, to just go out and continue on and have at least some fresh buses out in our system.
So to get us out of the mud here a little bit, I'm going to be clear as to why this is even coming up. So I'm going to cautiously go through this a little bit. You had mentioned the likes of FR conversions and companies that are out there like them that could possibly provide this that you're asking for. So I'm always challenged by the way in which decisions are made when it comes to government and spending. And Will, I think you know that. You're grinning at me because you and I both know how that works.
It's difficult because we have to go through a public procurement process.
And I understand that. But so I'll be blunt. Before the holidays, and Jeff, you know this. Both the Jeffs know this. So does Will. I said, why can't we go across the street and say, hey, y'all are making buses over here that we use. Can you make a couple for us? And just, I don't think there'd be a delivery charge because you could carry them across the street. And I was slapped on the wrist and said, okay, hang on now, there's a process, which is, again, one of the things that I get challenged by. Up until a certain period of time, the likes of FR conversions couldn't provide that service. But now that they have a sales force in place, that's why I sort of prompted this discussion. So I'm anxious to hear more about what you all have, the process here about perhaps will your company purchasing and allowing us to lease. So is that where we are at this point?
No.
Yes, no, or what?
No, and I can explain to you why why we are where we are. So obviously we can beat why there's not enough buses and why the state doesn't produce them to death. But the fact is there aren't enough buses to be successful. So, you know, one option, of course, is to go over to FR conversions, as you said. But FR conversions, the buses they produce, don't meet the best needs of the transit system based on the ratio of wheelchairs to ambulatory patients. Okay, and you know there was a cost to that would be accessing county funds to buy a capital bus at X dollars. We looked at other options from other vendors, local vendors, to purchase a vehicle that maybe met the better seating requirements. Because if you're going to invest the money, you want to invest one that meets the best needs of the transit system with the seating ratio. You don't go out and spend tens of thousands of dollars and then come up with a seating ratio that's short. That was one option. One option for us to do was to purchase them as Ride With Us and lease them to the county until the state produced the buses. We could do that. The problem is that didn't allow the county to access some state funds, which Jeff will go into in a second, that have been grant funded to the county, so they wouldn't have to access their own funds. If you want to access the grant funded money, you have to go through this county. Well, you have to follow the LOTS manual, which is the state manual for transportation, and follow the procurement process to get a vendor to lease them, which then Ride With Us obviously can't lease them. You'd have to go to a third-party vendor. So in short, you know, getting to the point, as you said, cutting through the mud, it comes down to if you want to access your own funds, the county funds, then you can do it any way you want. You still have to go through it. If you want to access the state funds, you have to go through the LOTS manual and the county procurement. Is that pretty?
Right.
We have to.
Even the county funds, you have to use the county procurement.
So, okay. What request did we leave?
Commissioner, we had some challenge too. I just want you to go.
Well, no, and I get that, and that's probably why I got smacked before the, which was rude, by the way, before the holidays. I get that, but I also say when you're in a situation like we are, which is obviously we're in a critical situation here. I mean, let's not beat around the bush. We had an axle fall off a bus before the holidays, yes, or come apart. If
yes.
you will. I mean, if that's not critical, then I don't know what is.
Yes. Right.
So there's got to be a way to be able to make this process easier instead of saying, okay, well, we'll go through the procurement process, and come July we'll be able to have a bus in here. To which I say, what?
So, Steve, let me ask you a question. You said we approached the governor's office. Did we say to the governor's office, I don't know what was said. I don't know who said it, but look, we got a critical situation. It's been 3 years. Just give us a check. Cancel our order. Give us a check. We'll get our own buses. Has anybody asked the governor to give us a check instead of getting the buses for us?
You know, I don't think that the problem is. I think that would open us up to a whole. We'd be more challenged then because we rely on the state contracts in reference to grant funding and everything else to get these vehicles. And if we do that. Then it's all on us.
We do our own procurement. Big deal. We can buy trucks. We're smart enough to buy buses. We know how to do it. Our people are smart enough to do it.
Yes, but still.
The state apparently isn't smart enough to do it.
We lose the grant funding, and it costs us X amount more.
That's my point. The governor says, look, cancel Carroll County's order. Give them the check instead. Let them get their own buses. What's wrong with that?
First, I don't think the governor has. I don't know.
It's one of his aides, an executive agency. They say he's an executive agency.
A lot of the money's coming from that. Yeah, but to Will's point, the 16 buses have been a problem for the last 2 years and that have been discussed in this very forum.
And nobody's answering the question. Everybody's supposition. Did anybody say to the governor, just direct SHA and MTA to give us a check and cancel our order?
Now.
Well, that's the question that we should ask the governor. That's about a one-paragraph letter.
Well, it does get a little bit
It's
more.
Critical. 3 years, we had an axle call fall off a bus. They got 200,000 miles. We're putting the safety of our citizens at risk. Give us a check so we can get our own buses. And then we'll order them ourselves. And we'll go across the street. Maybe we'll get a couple from FR.
That's not an option because it complicates things too much. Were we even to be given a check and try to get somebody to build them for us, then we'd have to have someone that we'd have to hire to be there to monitor the bus build, to make sure they're built according to specs, which would make the buses that much more expensive for us. So it's not really an option for us.
I got to get it. You know, we used to build destroyers. That's 300-foot-long ships in World War II in 1 week. And we can't get a bunch of stupid buses in 3 years. Because we're so hung up with our own regulations. This regulation designed to serve us are strangling us.
We do know that these 16 are coming. It's a matter of time right now.
Right.
And what we're trying to get is in this interim between now and when they come in, we need to bridge this gap. And this plan is intended to bridge
the
gap.
But we're going to lease them, and that's going to cost us a lot of money to lease.
What is the
cost? For the next 12 months, 18
months.
Once
you have more details, I mean, we're getting off on that.
All right, all right.
Well, why don't you finish what your presentation is, and then we can...
Well, I think it's a fair discussion to say that you do have some options, and as you pointed out, using county funds is an option if you just wanted to buy something. The buses right now are costing right at $60,000 per bus to have a 10-4 configuration with the four wheelchair accessible units as we need. So 60,000 a bus roughly. If we are going to go down the path of trying to even lease buses, we're going to have to install radios in them. We have radios now from the old CATS program, so we have radios, and all they'd have to do is be installed. It costs about $450 per radio to install them. We need a tablet, the device that tracks the ridership. That's about $359 per tablet. And then the mounts, locks, all of that, insurance. We're talking about roughly about $8,800 per vehicle for the year. And then whatever the lease cost would be
plus
on top
lease.
Of that. Pardon?
We went from $800 for radio and tablet.
The insurance is about $7,800 per year per vehicle.
Insurance.
So when you add that insurance and all the tablets, locks, radio.
The insurance we'd have to pay even if we weren't leasing.
Yes.
So that's not an incremental cost.
Yes. Well,
we're taking old buses out of service, replacing them with new
ones. I wasn't trying to put it in terms of incremental service. I was just trying to give you a sense of how much would be involved with these additional vehicles.
Well, no. I'm sorry. I disagree, Jeff. The only thing that's relevant to this Board of Commissioners is what is the incremental cost. We already funded where we're at. The insurance cost of $7,800 per vehicle is not incremental, is it? We're not adding the number, increasing number of vehicles, are we?
At this point, if I can... comment is the idea right now is we lease these buses. Right now we have, for lack of better terms, we have zero extra buses available to us. So you know, the other day we had two buses in for service. One was in a body shop. Another one came in on a tow truck, wasn't running. We're down five buses in one day. Ride With Us has done a phenomenal job to maintain, and they put every car, minivan, everything that we have with a Ride With Us sticker on it was out there picking up and dropping off citizens to make sure that they met, you know, the citizens' needs to be picked up and dropped off. It made it very difficult. They had supervisors and their executives out driving a Chevy Malibu to go pick up and drop off citizens to make sure everybody was serviced, and they've been going above and beyond. What we're trying to do is lease these additional vehicles.
How many? Yeah.
Right now, we'd really need about six in the short term, but anything at two minimum, four I think would actually meet a majority of our needs. The other buses that we have would get maintained and put as spares, so the higher mileage. So
you have to keep them insured.
They'd have to stay insured. They would have to stay on the road.
How many buses do we normally keep in reserve?
We have right now. We have
zero.
We have 28 buses to serve 28 bus routes.
How many of you would normally plan on?
So we have. So Dan, let me answer your question a little more in detail. There are currently 30 routes that run every day. The county owns. There are 28 buses. Everything else is ancillary. What I consider a minivan, a car, things that aren't ideal for running the routes. Okay. Typically, the state recommends, in the last meeting, about a 20% spare ratio. You have a net sub-zero spare ratio, and part of the reason for that is when we took over, we were servicing about 390 demand response clients a day. We're currently servicing almost 700, so that's why your net sum ratio has continued to decline. The anticipation we took over about 18 months ago now, 19 months ago, was that these buses from 2014, 15 rather, I'm sorry, would be 14. many years ago, would be showing up. And of course, here we are 3 years later.
But if they had showed up, we'd still be in, then we'd be insuring them today.
We would be insuring them today.
So if we currently have 28, I'll try to get this simpler because we're using shifting reference points. We have 28 buses today. Right. If we had gotten the deliveries, the stuff we ordered, if we'd gotten the deliveries from 14 and 15, how many buses would we have in service today, and how many spares would we be out? Would we be keeping, continue to insure?
Of the 16 buses, 14 right now would be replacement, 2 would be expansion.
Okay, so we would be at 30 with how many, with 2 reserves? Is that what you're saying?
And that would build our spare ratio as well. There were a number of those that would build the spare ratio. So of the
So you should have 6 spares to meet the state recommendations. You currently have 0.
And in the funding we allocated for CATS to subsidize it, did we assume 6 spares?
I'm not sure what came over with CATS.
CTS. Excuse me, CTS. No. Did we? What did
so
we
fund? Your funding doesn't. Your operating funding that we are we mutually agree upon isn't granted on buses because the thought was the buses would be coming from the state that have yet to come. So the state doesn't allocate how those 16 will be used. Some will have to replace aging vehicles. Some were designed for expansion of bi-directional routes and what have you, and some were designed to increase the spare ratio. The state doesn't allocate, unless I'm wrong, of those 16. 2 have to be spares, 2 have to be – you get to, as an organization, decide how to allocate those 16 buses. Some will be used for increased service, some will have to replace dying vehicles, and some will have to be used for spares. Your service continued to grow over the past years, even predating us, on the thought that these buses would be coming in to make your spare ratio. They never came in. They still haven't come in, to be frank. So your spare ratio continued to sink. This isn't a problem that occurred last week, last month. But what's happened is you've deadlined vehicles for the safety of the citizens over the past several years. So vehicles have been deadlined by maintenance for various reasons and safety reasons, and there's been no replacement. That's how your spare ratio is incrementally decreased over the past several years.
Okay. What's the term of a lease?
Well, that's the whole point. Staff is here looking for an authorization to go forward and set out an RFP for the lease.
All right. Before
right. We have some funding in reserve that of some services we have not put in place yet because we have not received these buses. So operationally, we can utilize some of these funds to pay for the lease, at least on the short term, probably for over the next 6 months to a year. This is what we're looking to possibly to use to help at least fund the bus themselves.
All right, so let's go through the math real quickly.
Yeah.
To fit up each leased bus is gonna cost us about $800, and then another $7,800 a year to insure it. So for 1 year, assuming we have to lease them for 1 year, that's 6 buses times $8,800 is about $52,800. That does not include the lease.
That's correct.
How much is the lease going to be for the 6 buses, approximately?
Our estimate, I think what we've, again, rough estimate is about $2,000 a month per bus.
So $24,000 times 6, so about $150,000. So we're looking at about almost $200,000 total to lease 6 buses for 1 year.
And what kind of revenue would those 6 buses bring in?
You know the rate, the revenue money for those.
Not
enough to cover. The costs of these buses are not going to be offset by the revenue. The revenue is simply the buses are going to allow services to continue without being interrupted.
The 6 are going to spare, Dick. There'll only be two more. So the revenue of 2 buses is only going to be a fraction, like 5 or 10% maybe.
I would say 10% would be about
10%.
And we're going.
It's very minimal.
And we are going through a good amount of money in our maintenance fund because of these higher mileage vehicles on the road running every route full time. We'll give some estimates about $4,000 each time some of these higher mileage buses go into the shop. Each need about $4,000 of work. It's not just a simple oil change, lube oil change out the door. they're, every time they go in, they're needing a substantial amount of work each time they go in order to safely get back on the road.
Yeah, as Jeff alluded to, you have a significant amount of your bus fleet, approximately 40% or growing, over 200,000 miles, and you have several that approach the 300,000 mile mark. So the only return, Commissioner, we were going to see is not going to be in revenue. It's going to be increased fuel or maintenance costs. And I don't think I could fairly quantify that for you, but clearly it's going to exist, because when you have a bus that has 0 miles on it or minimum miles on it getting maintenance versus a bus that has 300,000 miles on it, you can hypothesize the difference.
So let me go back to something that commissioners, my fellow commissioners, ask. You said it's not that easy, commissioners, because we can't just order them from a company like FR Conversions across the street, because we don't have to have supervisors to meet the safety standards. Well, certainly everything FR Conversions manufactures meets National Highway Traffic Safety Administration safety standards. Whose standards are we talking about? MTAs?
Yes. Would be, so something we'd have to do.
Wouldn't MTA have the authority to say, since we can't deliver, we're going to waive our standards on this one crop of buses as long as they meet NHTSA requirements?
I know this.
I'm trying to use common sense here. Isn't this amazing how problematic it is?
But unfortunately, you have three government entities involved. The money comes originally from the federal government to the states. The states then distributed for various purposes, purchase of buses is one of them, to the local jurisdictions. So it's not really within the governor's purview, even if he wanted to, as I said earlier.
So he's suggesting the federal regulations are constraining us now, because the feds have dictated, so we need to call Donald Trump.
He just stepped it up a notch.
He probably
got to give it a week.
We might want to wait a little bit.
Yeah. And also, just to back up on the whole procurement process, I know it's frustrating for all involved with government procurement, but it is a process that's been developed over the years in order to protect you as elected officials, staff, as well as and to give citizens of the comfort level that they know how government money, their tax dollars, their money is being spent. That, you know, you're not just running to your best friend and giving him all the contracts, not that I'm, for any particular government purchase. I mean, that obviously happened in the past at some time, and therefore rules were made against it. So I know it's a frustrating process. I understand really why, but it is for everyone's protection and for the openness of the
process. This is the metaphorical equivalent of starving someone to death so we can make sure their food supply is safe, so we're starving to death instead.
It would make more sense for us to go out and purchase two new buses than to lease six.
That's correct, Dick. That's really where I'm going with this. We're looking at $200,000. We could buy three buses, go across the street, and just buy three new buses from our conversion
right process.
That's where I was
going. Own
them,
have them.
Thank you.
And instead
exactly.
Putting money into leases.
We just go buy three new buses across the street. We'll get them and loan them forever.
Certainly an option out there.
And of course, there's no more. I'd rather do that. We'll cancel a couple of them from the state.
So that's where this all started. And it all started with an estimate of not the configuration that you're looking at, 10-4, which I kind of like that configuration, by the way, 10-4.
It is a good one, isn't it?
But it was... You all right? Was it 6-1 that we got a price on, Jeff? Because when I...
Right, so you got a price from FR Conversions.
5-1, 6-1.
So
the conversation came up that for an extra approximately $12,000, $14,000, you get a configuration that better serves the needs of the citizens and has more wheelchair vans. So if you're going to go out and buy a capital investment, this was my opinion.
And I get that, Will. I get that. But if we're trying to put a Band-Aid on a bullet wound here... It seems to me that perhaps these guys are where I was originally when we were trying to come out of the gate with this, and we had what I thought was an attractive price for a 5-1 configuration, which means five regular seats and one wheelchair, correct? That's the configuration. Now, so I get the fact that that doesn't long-term isn't the best, but, again, we're trying to fix something here in the interim.
So you could purchase 10-4 buses today, if the commissioners approved it. I mean, there are vendors, one's as local as Frederick, and I don't know, maybe FR can produce them, at that configuration, at ballpark $58,000, having spoken with the vendor at a 10-4. So the problem with the Band-Aid is, as you elaborate to, we've been Band-Aiding for years now by putting minivans or the ProMaster or cars into it, and what happens is If a ProMaster van or a minivan can't take wheelchair patients, then what you do is you end up putting two minivans on to meet the route of one bus. So then you double your fuel cost, you double your labor cost.
Well, I was in for our conversions. You were too, I think. They were using extended chassis, I think, Sprinters. They're certainly bigger than 5.1. They have diesel engines.
I'm not suggesting.
Well, the only reason I'm bringing up 5.1 is because that was out of the gate. When this was suggested that we could get two, and I think we were looking at two, reasonably priced with a 5.1 configuration, that would help us in the interim. I know that it's not the best thing, Will, but but my point here was we're trying to find something that'll help us through this critical time.
Well, if we're going to purchase the truck by purchasing two buses or three buses, whatever, why wouldn't we purchase the, 10-6 or whatever, 10-4 bus that would serve us in the future? What difference does it make whether, we can get them right now or as quickly as we could get right. from anywhere else, why not get what we need? If we're going to purchase, and I'm not against purchasing three or whatever it comes up to, why not get what we want? That way we have them in the future, the right bus for our needs, and we don't have to worry about, as you said, occasionally maybe putting two buses on the same route to handle the load.
Or could we alternate these buses with others or move it? Some bus, use this one for another purpose and take one out of service and put it on a route?
So ultimately, if the commissioners agree to purchase or put out the procurement for the purchase and for whatever vendor appropriate, you know, that procurement failed, to purchase three vehicles, then what you do is you take your 300,000-mile bus and you sit it in the lot and you hope to never use it until you get to this tight point, this crushing point we're at now. And then you hope that they get you through the 6 months until the state gets their procurement together.
Sure, but once we own the buses,
you're, and I will point out, since we spoke last month, that if you own these three buses, you're not hamstrung like you are with the previous CATS buses where you can only use them for VA, you can't use them. Right. The county's property, the county can use them in any way, shape, or form the commissioners or their staff deem necessary.
We can even sell them if we want, once the state vehicles come in.
Or use them for other special events or...
Yeah. So what's the biggest configuration FR could build? I'm curious.
I have no direct knowledge. We don't know.
Okay. Jack? On behalf of that for our business growing company, when I was asked to do this, Jeff Topper sent me something that said five. I was just out there. FR will build any kind of bus you want. They even questioned the 10-4. So, I mean, I don't want anybody to walk away and think they can't build you a custom bus, you know, and they would like to work with you. They have all kind of buses out there. And so I just want you to know that they could build the 10-4 bus. They could build any kind of bus that we want. I don't want to get involved in everything else, but when I was asked to do a 5-1. That was all. I wasn't asked to do anything else.
That was only because we were kind of shooting from the hip, Jeff.
Right.
We were shooting from the hip, and you came back to me and said, here's the price on a 5-1, and I went, okay, well, that's a good price. It was cheaper than a pickup truck. So that's why I said, okay. And then we talked, okay, well, maybe that's not the best because it's only 5.1. Mm-hmm. It would be better if we had 10-4s or whatever, 8.2s or whatever.
Sure.
It was.
We were exploring options.
We were just exploring options out of the gate when that first subject came up. That's where that came from.
I'd be more than happy to go back with the different specs and talk to Ellie about it. Ellie would like to do business with us. I don't know about the purchasing.
Why don't we, as a board?
Well, one question. Commissioner, before you go there, just want to confirm something. Do you have the budget? Before we authorize it, do you have the money in the budget to do it? Do you need incremental money?
We have operating monies now. But we're using some of those operating monies for the pilot program. Whatever the pilot program was budgeted somewhere around the $55,000, $58,000 mark, as best as I can remember.
Okay, so there's 58 grand?
Of the total 185 that we had set aside for this. So whatever we use out of the pilot program is taking away from that 185.
Operationally, if we lease through the procurement process by MTA, FTA, we can lease, during a lease, that's considered an operational cost. We can utilize some of those funds. If we choose to go and purchase buses, then we will need money from the commissioners in order to go make this purchase. We cannot use this operational money for purchasing of buses. Leasing through the FDA, MTA, lots manual requirements, following the procurement, we can lease it.
Yeah, but you can use some of the operational money of the 100 or whatever thousand it is that we're not using for the pilot program. So whatever money is left over from that is what you're talking about using for the leasing, correct?
That's correct.
So that's not that much money. I wouldn't figure it to be that much, so I don't see that as a roadblock.
Can we
be my opinion that we would ask staff to explore purchasing three buses from FR Conversion or whoever else, but let's say FR Conversion, with a 10-4 ratio and see what it would cost us and see how quick we could get those buses up there and running. And once you've explored that, come back to us with these are the figures that we can go with.
Can we lease with an option to buy? That would be we would structure it to, it depends if we decide to go long-term on a lease. We'd like to, at that point, like to have that option to buy.
So
we could put that into the bid process.
The money you have to lease that and then later purchase that vehicle.
Again, we still have to iron that out to make sure that that follows within the criteria from FTA, MTA,
mm-hmm.
that we can put that into the bid process.
There's one more question that has to be clarified because I think it wasn't comprehended by everybody. Maybe I might be one of the people who didn't comprehend it, but you said if we lease through the state, then we can use operational mm-hmm. monies. You didn't say that.
No.
What did you say?
Lease through the normal procurement process, and then you can use the state operational money.
That's what I just said.
Right. No. You said through the state procurement process.
I'm sorry. If we lease through the state, we can use operational money. Does that suggest that the state will subsidize our leases? Is that what you're trying to say, or is it still all county money?
No.
Explain it.
There's $185,000 operational money that we're not using because we don't have the bi-directional route.
Got it.
We are currently using some of that money for the evening pilot program. We can use the rest of that money if we lease buses because leasing is considered operational.
So then what you're saying is if we incur roughly $200,000 in lease expenses, $120,000 would already be subsidized by the state.
Would be part of the grant that we've already been given by the
state. So it's not going to cost us $200,000. It's going to cost us maybe $70,000 or $80,000.
Whatever the difference.
That's the point.
We could make the leasing just cost that much.
Right.
If we purchase buses, that is not an operational cost. Then there is no money in the grant for that. And so we have to go on our own county money. We have to get it from reserve contingency or something in order to purchase. But one way or another, we have to go through the public purchasing.
Yes, but the buy versus lease equation is really the opportunity cost is we lease at a net cost for a year of about $80,000 to the county, or we buy, if we were to buy three, it costs about $180,000 to the county.
Well, it's only the $80,000 to the county for that first year because once that operational money runs out, we don't have that.
Yes.
That would be the ongoing costs, including insurance, and other maintenance, and fuel costs that's ongoing from that point on.
It's a point worth making. I just want to make sure you understand. What's left of the $185,000 is good through this fiscal year. Okay, so when you're talking a year lease, you're already getting into the next fiscal year. We'd be applying for these $185,000 funds again, but they were really for three purposes: to put in a new route, Hampstead Manchester to Westminster, the bi-directional route that Roberta mentioned, and continuing, if needed, if wanted, the pilot program. Whatever we use of that money for leasing, when we get these buses for our order and we want to put, say, a new route and the bi-directional into place, then the dollars would have already been spent for the lease. You'd have to come up with the county funding to then do those things.
But as of right now, let me just clarify, between now and the end of this fiscal year, we do not have the buses. We do not have the new buses. So that money is there in that account that we'd use for leasing to the end of this fiscal year. We already estimate we could be 3 to 6 months, even after the start of FY18, until we receive these new buses, give or take. So we're looking at least 9 months, probably 9 months to a year right now, of funds that we could, you know, again, not knowing the entire cost of the bi-directional process, we probably wouldn't be putting these additional routes on until the start of calendar 18, at probably the minimum by the time we added them into the route, gone through the public process of adding these in, et cetera. So if you think about it, we have the remainder of these funds for this next 6 months, and then you would have maybe a portion of that money that we wouldn't be using because we're going to be 6 months into the next fiscal year. And that's, again, operational, because, again, this is operational money that's tied to federal and state money. That's why we have to go through that procurement process, and it's tied to operational.
So let me try to summarize this and be clear here, too, because I think we've bantered enough about this. Your suggestion at this point is to get permission to look into leasing, beginning the procurement process of leasing, yes?
Yes.
That's your suggestion.
However, that's our suggestion completely. Our approach of this is to, unless the commissioners feel differently, of purchasing the buses outright with own county money, this was an option that we have to lease without having to go, you know, there are some
contingencies.
Right. And that was the approach that we've been taking on this. If the commissioners feel differently or strongly that we want to purchase that, that you'd like to purchase them, and we have these buses on the long, you know, for the long term all the way throughout, that, again, that's...
Well, what you said earlier is that you, even if we lease these buses, you want them for the long term. Because you want them for, even if when we get to 16 from the state, you want to use these buses additionally for other routes or for in reserve or whatever. So we want these buses regardless of when we get to 16 for the state.
We would like to. It's just going to depend on the cost of the leasing past when the funding runs out.
So why not just buy buses, then we'll have them. And we just, to me, it makes more sense.
Could we have staff come back to us with both options? What it would cost to buy and lease, and then we could make that determination based on what the finances tell us.
You have to do it.
It's got to show the math.
Yeah.
Yes.
It has to show the magic math based on the state subsidies and whatnot. Also, you know, the bare minimums that we need to stay alive, and also what the delivery. Best guess is the delivery phase in for the new units. Are we not getting any of them this year?
Well, and some of that may be known, as I said earlier, at the very beginning of this, which is MTA folks are meeting with the contractor today. So we, as we are building this RFP, we may have more.
Has the state established a priority allocation scheme, given that we got this backlog of hundreds of units, where every county can get a couple of units priority if there are other units?
It's only, it's what's machined in the factory, so they're going to build a certain type of bus.
Configuration.
So and then go to the next configuration, and it just depends on what the number is. Again, these are numbers we just don't have an idea at this present time, number of chassis. I would estimate, our best guess is at least minimum of 6 months. We'd start, we'd see the minimum at this point, our best guess.
Yeah, I'm going to make a motion here. I move that, that the Board of Commissioners allow staff to proceed with a procurement process and come back to us with buying versus leasing. And in the best time period that is possible here. The shortest,
Okay, question about that, Steve. Do we want them to move with the procurement process, or do we want them to do a pro forma estimate of what the cost would be before we move forward with the procurement process?
All right, I'll reword it to say.
I'm asking.
Okay. But part of that's going to be, part of that is beginning the procurement process, obviously.
If I may, Commissioner, I would suggest that you do, if you want to go down both routes, you do an RFP for both, a purchase of three and the leasing of whatever you determine, three or six. Because if you wait for the pro forma, then you delay the RFP, then the buses has got to be built. We'll be July before we see your own buses.
Well, can we obtain estimates, though, quicker as opposed to waiting 3 months to go through a procurement process? We can make some phone calls and get some estimates, some not to exceeds.
The procurement process can be done more quickly than 3 months. And we have to go through the procurement process again. So
Yeah, but we're going to do two of them. We're only going to, we may exercise neither, or we may exercise one.
That's always your choice.
We need to have the figures first in front of us before we move ahead. What are the options, dollars and cents wise?
Well, that's part,
that's what your motion is.
So that's what the, yeah.
Okay.
Is that what you want?
So your original motion was to go through the procurement process for leasing and buying buses, correct? That was your original motion?
Yeah, I think so, Dale. Okay.
I would second that original motion.
Okay. We have a motion and a second.
All right, question. Couldn't we just issue in terms of an RFI, say, look, Carroll County's trying to decide whether to purchase at least six or buy three. Can you give us some estimates, estimated cost?
Wouldn't that what you're going
to
do?
To access the lease funds from the operational funds, Commissioner, you have to go through an RFP process. So regardless of which direction the commissioners chose to go, you're required, correct me if I'm wrong, essentially by state procurement to go through an RFP. You don't, that would be preferable, I agree, but it's not allowed.
Yeah, we can't do that.
Well, I'm just deciding that you're right. Right. I mean, that's fine. Okay. You're through procurement.
Either way, we have a 30-day procurement process, whether we choose to
correct.
Whether you choose to fund it by purchase or by lease. We can start that clock, as you know, in a few days and have that out on the streets.
Now, the clock needs to be started in a few minutes.
All right, so your motion stands, yes, Commissioner.
Yeah, so my motion, yeah.
Why don't you repeat it? Your original motion stands.
That's an easier
repeat. Yeah, that's a great
repeat it.
So, Joe, can you repeat it back?
I'll second it and repeat it.
It's already been second. Oh. It's
you can third it.
To allow staff to proceed with the procurement process.
Okay. All right. Two procurement processes. Yes. Buying and or leasing. Okay.
Motion's been made.
Before we vote, okay, that's fine. Before we vote, let's talk about the terms of the leases that you're going to solicit. Okay. We don't know whether we're going to get our buses, and is it possible to get any of our other buses from MTA in less than a year? We want to be locked in for a year? I mean, do we want to go for a 6-month, 12-month, without
so month the month? State has indicated to us that we
will do their homework.
We'll more than likely get some of those buses maybe before a year. We don't know, but some of them, we're not going to get them all at once.
Right. Plus, the fact is, you want to keep these additional buses anyway. So whether you get those buses 3 months down the road or a year down the road, we still want to keep these additional buses. So that makes no difference.
Well, I'm just trying to agree. So we want to... A one-year lease with month-to-month renewals, or one-year lease with annual renewals, whatever you want.
That's what they're going
to
come back with.
You make the decision. I'm not going
to
micromanage. Yeah,
and we can put in an option to purchase at a year.
Look into it in a second.
Okay,
now hold on. Before we go, I'm going to come in. I want to be clear about something here. We've heard the FR conversion come up here several times. And again, there's nothing here that I'm trying to do procurement process-wise. I merely use them as an example because they're local and they're across the street. The procurement process will go in the way in which it needs, and all companies that are available to bid on this will bid on this when we get to that point. Yes. I just want to make that clear. I don't sit on the board at FR conversions or anything else. I only use them as an example because they're local. That's all. If the Weaver Bus Company was on the other side of the street, I'd have used them, maybe. But I just want to make that clear. There was no intent here to steer this. I want the procurement process to move in the way in which it does. I just want it to move faster.
Which means when we do the procurement solicitation, there should be a delivery deadline specified. We don't want the low bidder who's going to take us 3 years to deliver. That doesn't buy us anything.
Right. So we'll put that in at that time.
And Will will then proceed to performing hari-kari.
And you can certainly talk to some vendors to find out what best they can do.
And then you will. And you'll be gone.
Because these questions are going
to
come back.
You can certainly talk to some vendors and find out what their best delivery is.
Just the one or two vendors I've spoken to, some have a lot and some are 8 weeks. And obviously the procurement will determine who the best vendor is. But I think 8 weeks is a probably realistic timetable for delivery.
Make sure you find out because that will come up, I'm sure.
Sure.
All in favor of the motion that's made and second?
Right.
Aye.
And we're going to pay for the runner up, but we're not doing the solicitation. Okay. We're going to call the vote. Go ahead.
We did.
Aye.
It's unanimous.
Aye.
Thank you,
gentlemen.
Thank you.
Please leave quickly.
By the way.
So, ladies and gentlemen, anyone that thinks the government can do things better than the private sector, this is a perfect example of, in spite of the joint brain power of all eight of us in here, nine of us. You can see how the government can screw something up as simple as buying some buses. Only government.
Did you count Tim in that count?
No, I left him out.
Okay.
Let's move ahead. A briefing discussion, possible decision, request approval for Meraki Wireless Network. And we have Mr. Mark Ripper and Jacob Gregory with us. Mark is Director of Tech Services and Bureau Chief for Tech Services.
So I challenge you to follow that.
I hope to be a lot of support for that, Commissioners.
Move to dismiss.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
The Department of Technology Services is requesting your approval to purchase the annual license renewals for the Meraki Wireless Network presently in use by Carroll County government facilities. Funding is provided by the FY17 Operating Fund, and the maximum purchase amount is $36,047. As part of that, you see that we have three quotes that were obtained. DISIS was the low bidder at $36,047, and Digicon and SHI were both in the $39,000 range. And Jacob, just give you a brief overview of what this system does for us.
It provides the wireless capabilities for the county, whether it be laptops or phones or anything that's wireless that connects to the network. You could be a guest or an employee. At any given time, we run approximately between 600 and 700 connections at a time. And that, to summarize, is this is the licenses for the system, the hardware, the software that provides that capability.
When you say for the county, what do you mean? You mean any citizen of the county or just all the, like, Carroll County government?
For all Carroll County government offices. Okay. Senior, it includes senior centers, maintenance center, that type of thing. Yeah, it would be nice if we had one for the entire county, wouldn't it?
So I thought you meant, but we did counties. Whoa.
I keep wishing.
Sounds better. Okay. Yeah, I know. It's a deal.
Is there a reason why it's annual? I hate to bring this up because it may go in a bad direction here, but could you save money if it was, you know, every three, every two, blah, blah, blah?
Yeah, we actually did have one company that put in a three-year bid. And what I'm going to try and do with the budget office this year, we don't have the funding to cover that. So do you remember what the three-year cost was from the one from the same organization, wasn't it?
$65,000.
Right, $65,000 for 3 years, but I don't have $65,000 in my budget. What I'd like to do is work with the budget office through this next budget process and see if there's some way that we can have a sum of money put aside in the budget, not for any specific project, but if somebody comes through and makes us one of these offers, the funding would be there for us to be able to take advantage of that.
Okay. I know there's, you know, obviously there's an advantage,
sure,
too.
The other thing we're going to be doing, Commissioners, is with any purchase of any new products moving forward, we're going to be getting those quotes with 1, 2, and 3 year service agreements up front, so that way we can make that decision at the point of purchase. Yeah, this is a really good deal for 3 years, and we won't have to come back before you before that time frame.
So, okay, since you brought that up.
See, now who is it?
So it's 60, how much for 3 years?
65.
65 is compared to 36 for 1 year. And there's no way to get unrestricted loans from unrestricted funds from TED to pay that extra, basically, $14,000 or $20,000 for an additional 2 years?
We could look at, like, if you direct us to do that, we could move forward and look at that. It's the same company. It would not change the award of the bid. It's the same company. It's DISIS still that provided that quote. I can pursue that with the budget office if you'd like me to do that. That's not a problem.
So how does that affect the term of the license, though? Are you coming up on the end? Where are you with your term?
What are we, about 3 weeks out?
Correct.
Yeah.
Is that going to jam you up?
No, because, I mean, I don't know. I guess you would have to speak to this, Tim. If you awarded the contract based on the quotes that we got here, DISIS is the low bidder. We awarded the DISIS for 1 year at $36,000. And then we could pursue the possibility of extending that out for 2 years? Or do they have to award it the $65,000? And we could come back. I mean, you have session next Thursday. We could come back with that.
If you came in the room.
Well, it's just if we can say, you know, according to the bottom, and I've never been real good at math, but, you know, according to this, we're either going to spend $36,000 a year for the next 3 years, and that's probably going to go up, or we're going to lock in for three at 65, which saves a ton of money.
Correct.
Well, there's a third option, Commissioner.
Turn your phone off. And then
third option is we negotiate a five-year contract, which gives us renewal options each year at a discount. We might get a better price that way as opposed to renewing them each year.
Was that an option, though, with DISIS?
I have three options, 1, 3, and 5 years.
Yeah.
The greatest savings is for 5 years.
But they want to lock into five. We could say to DISIS, look, we want to give you a five-year contract. We're going to pay annually, and we have cancellation privileges.
I presented this question. In this particular case, sometimes that is an option. In this particular case with this company, that was not an option. To get that type of discount for 5 years, $88,000, just over $88,000, it would have we would have to have paid all of it up front. It's a large discount, but it was due up front.
And again, in the future, we can explore some of those things as we move forward with some of our larger contracts. We can look at those types of things and see if they are possible. Most of the time, commissioners, in my experience with technology, is the reason they're giving you the discount is because they're getting the cash up front.
No, I don't agree.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I don't. I've dealt with this for years, 20 years of my life, and if we could negotiate a three-year contract with them where there is no escape, but we only pay them annually. That happens, and they'll give you a discount to know that they've got the business locked up for 3 years or 5 years, yet we still only pay annual. I'm sure there'll be a bigger discount if you pay up front because of the time value of money, but we should still be able to negotiate better pricing if we went with a five-year contract where we just pay them every 12 months.
And sometimes that is an option.
Could you check with the budget office to see if there are some unrestricted funds that could be used to make this a three-year contract instead of a one-year contract and then come back to us next Thursday?
I could, Commissioner.
Would that be the consensus of the board?
Since I brought it up, yeah. I mean, it just appears to me like we're going to save a great deal of money here if we can lock into a three-year versus a one-year ongoing or five.
Can I inject?
Sure.
Just the, could I include 5 years? You mentioned 1 and 3.
Sure. Yeah, that would be fine. That's excellent. I just think my only question would be, you know, as a result of negotiating that sort of a contract, with the way in which technology changes every 10 minutes, how would that affect the contract moving forward? I mean, would there be changes that would not be included if we were locked into 3 or 5 years?
No, what this is what we call licensing. It's a standard practice in the technology industry. This is really the right for us to be able to use the software in order to make the system work. This is a new system, so I have no problems going out to 5 years. I expect it to last at least 6-7 years from the day without any significant changes. So a 5-year contract on this one, I don't anticipate being.
See if you get an annual payment or 5 years. See what you
We checked into the annual payment. They would not do that.
Ted Zaleski's in the back of the room. I see him having heartburn, I think. Ted, you want to say anything? The idea of prepaying multi-year operational service or licensing contracts?
You had to prompt him, didn't you?
Well, he was getting ready to say something.
I wasn't. I was just listening. No, there's no problem with that. I mean, in one way, you know, budgeting the same amount every year is easier, but if it makes sense for us to budget a lump and then follow it with less, I mean, we can work that out.
Okay.
I would see all what right. You can come up with.
See what you can work it out.
Yes.
Okay.
And if you need a negotiator, Commissioner Rothschild is definitely available.
Okay.
Hey, Ted, sorry. If we did something like this with 5 years, when once you get to the 5-year, that's a magic number in some cases for capital. Would it be responsible to look at that as a capital acquisition?
It really doesn't matter. That just becomes a matter of labeling. I mean, it's the same money either way.
Well, okay. Thank you.
Okay. We will follow up. We'll be back next week.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Briefing. Don't turn my phone off between now and then.
No, it's okay. You're good.
Thanks.
You have half a week. Okay. We're ready to move on here to a briefing discussion possible decision on a request for approval for additional funds for Carroll County Farm Museum maintenance. We have Jack Lyburn, Director of Economic Development, Bonnie Staub, Office of Tourism, and Joanne Wendt, Manager of the Carroll County Farm Museum.
That's Jack Lyburn. I haven't seen Jack Lyburn.
We don't see him much.
Yeah, where's he been?
It's twice today in appearance. I'm amazed.
Well, when you have one of our fastest growing companies in our backyard, you know, I just
thought. We put dollars and cents with it.
You should hear that, you know, they can do, I hate to get this bus controversy, but they can do it. I just wanted you to know that they can do it. I have some data I guess I want to share with you before we go into the meat of our request. The Farm Museum is 140 acres. It has 54 buildings. Now, last year, we had more than 40 special events, and this year, we have a couple more booked already. We had 3,155 volunteer hours logged in 2016. 3,155 volunteer hours. I think that's incredible for people like in Carroll County. We have, so far this year, for 2017, we had 22 weddings already booked. And that's at $2,000. And next year we're raising it over $2,000. But 22 already booked for 2017. We had 1,391 students from Carroll and other counties toward the museum in 2016 as part of their school field trip. So we're ramping that up now. And the thing we're really excited about that we get to Joanne and Stephanie going after. Museum is going to host a Smithsonian traveling exhibit from May through July this year. It's called The Way We Work. This is a grant-funded exhibit that was only awarded to a handful of sites throughout the state. And the museum will be offering exhibits on Carroll County's canning industry in conjunction with this project. So we're really excited about that. I'm reading this because I don't want to miss anything. Usually I don't read from notes. The request for $150,000 is for general maintenance on museum's 54 buildings. We would like to do the work now instead of requesting it through the capital improvement process because we would like to finish user repairs before our wedding season begins in April and the Smithsonian exhibit opens at the end of May. I'd like to thank Jeff. We went through and did a project. We looked at all the buildings and we came up with this $150,000 number for maintenance. These are just maintenance that we need to do on the buildings. We'll be working with Mike Myers to put the RFP out through the projects. And now I'm going to stop and see if there's any questions. My two experts are to the right of me asking for the $150,000. And hey, if you have any questions, you can ask the two experts to the right of me.
Is $150,000 in the CIP anywhere?
It is not. It will be next year. We did not put it in. Yes. We didn't anticipate. As we went through and did the analysis last year, it's minors, but when you put all 54 together, it comes up to about $140,000.
Is there any CIP money in the five-year plan for the Farm Museum capital improvements or repairs?
You have to ask the people sitting behind you on that. Yes, Jeff.
Is that a no?
It's going to be proposed in the long term, in the next 6 year capital budget process to go over the next 6 years.
So do you need the money as part of FY17 or FY18 funds?
18 and
all. So you don't need us to fund it until July of this year?
No, that's not what you're asking for.
No, we're asking for the funded now.
Asking for the monies to do these repairs.
Before the Smithsonian, before the summer, before the wedding start. To get all the repairs done, working with our purchasing and working with you know, Jeff and his staff and with Eric. We're asking for the money now instead of waiting for next year, putting it in our CIP for next year.
So here, this, here, okay. You want me to go?
Go ahead.
So first of all, we see a ton of positive come out of the Farm Museum. Let's be clear. And even when we had Secretary Barkfelder up here, who had never been here before, he's walking around like somebody who just got off the bus in New York City for the first time with his mouth open.
Well, so fortunately, you're looking at these two ladies. Well, these two ladies that are blind.
I'm trying not to look at you.
Yeah, well, you need to look at them, and not look at me.
Yeah, yeah. So let's be
they're
clear.
The ones.
Let's be clear about that too.
Yes.
you know, you mentioned some of the stats, Jack, and 22 weddings at $2,000 a pop. So
$44,000.
There's $44,000 that comes back in that makes this maybe a little bit more acceptable.
Plus a lot of sponsorships that they're getting for different events.
Correct. So I guess where I'm going with this conversation is, if we would be able to do this and get it out of reserve for contingencies, it's not like we're not going to see something in return for it. I mean, we kind of had this conversation about a similar issue here, 20 minutes ago. What is the return? I think we know what the return is here. And honestly, with everything that goes on out there, there's probably more of a return above 150
that
would offset that, you know.
I can't tell you with sponsorships. I don't want to say we were at 0 years ago. We were at 4,000 or 5,000. Our last year, our sponsorships were a little under $40,000. These are sponsorships going out to companies, and they're up. And we're talking about a couple of new events this year. And if we do that, we did Fall Harvest. Commissioner Weaver, I think we did 1,000 last year. We did how much? 7,000 this year. We've ramped up all our sponsorships, and people want to come back. You've all been out there, you know, doing our event. So we have a lot more sponsors than we ever have, and people want to come out now. So we're hoping our goal is to do $50,000 in sponsorships. Is there a payback? Of course there's a payback. But these are just general maintenance we just like to get done, especially with Smithsonian, with all the children coming in the summer. If we don't do it, we would be sitting here probably doing a lot of them in the fall and the following year. Plus, we're bringing the worm seed on. Remember, we got the grant for the worm seed. So it's the only worm seed in the operation as far as in the whole United States and maybe the world. So we want to bring people in. So we want to kind of spruce up the place. And, you know, just general maintenance. We're not looking for any, you know, replacing buildings or anything.
Can I ask Ted, funding for this? Do we have it? Where would it come from?
There is no funding in place. You can do one of two things. What you're being asked for right now is a transfer of money to make it available in fiscal year 17. That's a choice you can make. We're working on the 18 through 23 CIP. You could choose to put money in that, but then nothing would happen this year. That would be money that's available after July 1st.
I love the Farm Museum. I love the work you're doing. I love going there. But I'm very concerned about the precedent this establishes. I mean, there's time to make exceptions. And if there's a clear, compelling, exigent circumstance, it's a fancy way of saying an emergency. A roof fails that's only a few years old. A heating system fails only a few years old. We should not be funding this kind of money outside of the budgeting process unless you can directly point to items here that could not be reasonably anticipated. Now, there's 54 items. Is there something there that could not be reasonably anticipated? Otherwise, we should just... Once we do this, gentlemen, what do we do the next time? It sends a message to every agency in this county that we're going to entertain these types of requests. Now, if you walked in and said, we had an earthquake, the roof failed, we've got to spend $100,000 to stabilize the building, it could not have been reasonably anticipated, therefore we should be given an exception outside the budget process, I would say right on. I don't know that this qualifies for
I can't tell you there's structural... do we have some minor roof leaks? Yes. But, I mean, there's no structure. We're not having buildings fall down. This is just maintenance that we need, minor roof leaks and snowbirds and things like that on the roof. So I can't sit here and tell you that we have structural problems.
Can we do this in phases with a portion now and the rest in 18?
Of course we can.
And for the roof leaks and things like that, what would it cost to get those fixed this year and then do the rest in the 18 or the next budget or after this fiscal year?
We had two RFPs out for some masonry work and for snowbirds, and it was around like $40,000 or $50,000 to patch it up some minor roof leaks. It's those kind of numbers that we could do this year, because we're not going to be able to probably do all these projects this year too.
Well, that was my question. I think that's where you're going. Maybe
yes.
It was, you know, perhaps identifying what is crucial, and kind of tagging on to what you were saying, because I get what you're saying, although I'm not sure I totally agree with that line of thinking, but I do get what you're saying. But maybe identifying what's crucial now and making sure that the rest of it is included beginning for the FY18 during the budget process. And I don't know, can you? I know you can. I know you can.
We can work with.
If you've got over 50 things, you're not going to get those done before.
I don't think we have. We don't have 50. We probably have a couple dozen.
Remember, we got to go through the RFP process. There's, nobody's going to be able to go out to work there probably until September anyway.
We get them back in 2 or 3 weeks.
Whatever.
Takes 2 or 3 weeks for our RFPs, so we don't.
No, we follow county RFP. That will be the only way we do anything.
We agree with that.
Is there a way that you can do that, Jack?
Sure, yeah.
Identify the.
Yes, Commissioner, we could do that.
Possibly, it would be good to have, you said about $50,000, $60,000 would probably.
$50,000 would take care of our issues.
Maybe if you get the authorization up to that amount,
right.
Then move forward.
Especially if it's leaking roofs or something, if that lets go, it's going to get worse and worse and worse. Instead of $50,000, looking at $100,000 in a very short amount of time.
Could we work with our public works department? If we are, maybe we'll ask for $50,000 and work with that, you know, up to, and if we don't spend it, it'll be there next year. Roberta, thank you. Commissioner, I'll
just want to be careful on that last idea. If you transfer $50,000 this year and it doesn't get done this year, it won't be available next year.
No, I don't think that's right. To the fund balance. What Jack meant is he'd have spending authority up to $50,000 for these repairs this year, and then next year's will be taken care of in the CIP or in the budget.
That would be a problem with the purchasing department to get that done.
How old is the roof that's failing?
I don't think that roof has been touched since Mark Duvall came to the museum, so we're talking almost 20 years.
So should we be patching it or replacing it? And if it's 20 years old, why wasn't it in the CIP?
That predates my time at the museum. All I can tell you is that it's the Alms Barn roof, and that's our original barn, and we do have leaks on the exhibits. We also have historic masonry work that has to be done to certain standards because it's part of the historic buildings and the historic register. So that work, it is more difficult to find masons who can do it according to the historic standards, and it can be a little bit more costly.
Joanne, I think I speak for my fellow commissioners when I say all of us want to help, but I think all of us also we want to be careful about transmitting this message. It's an emergency. It was not reasonably something that could be reasonably anticipated. You should be here. I'm just concerned that this just is mismanagement, a lack of management, a lack of oversight, a lack of proper acuity and time being spent in the budget process to ask for these things, because you certainly would have gotten them. And I just don't want this to become a precedent for our other agencies.
And I understand that, Commissioner, and I do appreciate your support, but you might also remember that I've only been at the museum for 2 years, and some of these things probably should have been addressed or for other reasons under previous boards were not addressed.
I understand, Joanne.
And you realize the government process is not fast, which we just went through earlier today, and we need to, I think, at this point, look at what we can do right now and then address this, a lot of it, into the next budget. We'll have to, you know, make sure it's put into it.
So I think that the appropriate thing for us to do is to recommend that they get a list of what are the emergencies that have to be dealt with immediately and come back and give us a number on that.
Well, I would like to see, like the Board of Commissioners to authorize up to $50,000 of work that needs to be done immediately for roofs and masonry and so forth, that because if it isn't done, it deteriorates quickly, and it's going to cost us more money in the long run. So why not take care of the things, and whatever they are, I mean, I would trust your expertise in telling what those were, get them taken care of, and if it's cost $20,000, costs up to $50,000, you know, get that taken care of so we don't have those problems lingering in the future. That's what I would like to see happen.
Is that a motion?
Ted?
Well, I couldn't make it one.
Well, I'm just asking.
Yeah,
I
mean, let's get some. Let's see what Ted says.
This isn't specifically about this request in front of you today, but just some bigger ideas that are coming out of this conversation that are concerning me. We have two ways that some of this kind of work done, not just the Foreign Museum, but all of your buildings. Some money is budgeted every year in the facility's operating budget, and certain projects are identified. So some of that happens in your operating. And we do have capital projects identified, and more can be identified in the future, will be. With the Farm Museum, we're talking about $150,000 of some repairs right now. There's a total request that we're looking at for something in excess of $1 million. Clearly, you're not going to come up with $1 million today, but we will be evaluating that for other future projects in the CIP. But not just the Farm Museum, but for all of your infrastructure, I mean, there's a continuing effort to say what needs to get done, what's the highest priority. But one thing we know, I mean, one of you just made a statement, I'm sure if it had been identified, it would have been budgeted. And I'm going to say that it's not true. You know, there's not enough money. We can identify a lot more stuff right now than I can find money for you to be able to put in the budget. And arguments for a lot of things that piece by piece you would say, well, how are we not doing this? And the answer is because there's something else that we said was even more urgent than this piece. So I don't want anybody walking away with an idea that some things haven't gotten done just because nobody thought about it or nobody bothered to budget for it. It's a constant struggle to figure out what's going to get the money next.
I really do appreciate what Ted just said. But when you have over 30 to 40,000 people come at an event with children, we are a money maker. And we talked about the $44,000 in weddings, and we talked about, you know, the $40,000 that we didn't have at special events. We're talking $75,000-$80,000. I think it justifies, especially this is the gem of the county, and I think with all these people that come here, and 3,155 volunteer hours, they're there. They believe in it too, and I think it's a little bit different personally. You know, we're a money maker. Tourism is a money maker, and economic development is a money maker, and you support a tourism and economic development issue. This is a tourism project. A lot of people come here. You know, our staff is ramped up and doing a great job, and, you know, I just hope, you know, there is a payback on this money.
I'll make a motion that the Board of County Commissioners approve a request of up to $50,000 to address the project at the Farm Museum.
Second.
The motion has been made and second that we approve $50,000
up to
$50,000 for immediate repairs. Any comments?
The only comment that I would have, Dick, is, you know, again, I get the numbers. To all of you, I get the numbers. I just want to be very careful here so as not to open up that can of worms for everybody to come marching in here to ask for whatever. So I want to make it very clear that I second this motion because I trust that you're going to be able to identify those items of repair that need to be done immediately. And then we'll deal with whatever the request is for the FY18 as we go through our CIP procedure or whatever that is as we move forward in the FY18. So I second it based on that.
That is correct. You are correct.
And again, too, you know, if we're only going to allow for the $50,000, based on what you're bringing in, just with the wedding thing, you've almost zeroed out here. So, I want to be clear. I'm not trying to set a precedence here. But I think this is important enough because I agree. It is the gem. And anybody that goes there will say that.
Well,
so,
if any precedent should be set here is that we should put more money into maintenance of our facilities and our roads and our buildings so we don't have these requests come up at a budget session that are necessary. We have to put more into maintenance. We really do.
Joanne, how long have you been at the helm at the Farm Museum?
2 years in December.
Okay, so I'm gonna tip my hand. I'm going to vote for this. but I want to make clear why. When you take over a big responsibility like that, it takes you a year or so to get grounded. But if you'd been in this job for 10 years, I would be voting against this right now. But since you're new at the job, it takes you a while to figure out what's going on, get your arms around it, I think that you're entitled to special dispensation in this case. So I will support it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I'm going to excuse myself from this vote as I serve an ex officio as a Board of Governors there. So it's approved, 3 votes in favor.
Commissioners, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And Joanne, that was a vote of confidence in you.
Okay.
By the way, Bonnie, it goes unnoticed, too, the amount of tourism dollars that are coming in to this county and the state. I just got an email not yesterday, I believe, in reference to the monies that are coming in tourism-wise. And I know that you're hosting that group again soon.
I'm hosting the MAC group for Anthony this month.
District 1. Shout out to District
1. Where is that?
Get over so,
but anyway, thank you. You know,
Commissioners, over $6 million has been put on the bottom line of this county because of tourism. Yeah. We just got the new numbers.
I just think that needs to be said. And you know, so.
The Farm Museum is a fantastic job. Enjoying, you're doing a great job as managing it. So
it's these two.
It doesn't go unnoticed, Bonnie, your efforts into it.
Thanks.
Commissioners, thank you.
Okay, let's review minutes from December 15th.
Move to approve.
I'll second those. Any questions?
Hang on 1 second. I just want to read this 1 section on the scores. Talk about the disposition of these schools. The one thing that we continue to seem to overlook is the possibility of bringing in someone like Jack Lieberg to test the marketability as a lease property or a sale property. So the minutes are accurate, but I do want to say to the commissioners, we may need to bring that back up in the future because it seems like it keeps getting lost.
Things will come back, I'm sure.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, all in favor for December 15th?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. It's unanimous. We'll move on to December 22nd.
Motion to approve.
What's your name ahead?
Yes. It's like we might
get these. Is that that teacher thing coming out on you or what? Second. Okay.
Now, okay, I'm good with it. I'm good
with
it. Okay.
I'm good with it. Okay, I'm good.
Okay.
What?
Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. And that's it on minutes. Move ahead to agendas for week one, January 9th. And we have the Maryland Department of Planning training session here at 5 p.m. Is that 5 o'clock or 5:30?
It's 5.
5 o'clock in the Reagan Room. On that, and that will have all 5 commissioners here, I think, or not. Tuesday, January 10th. Carroll County State of the County at Carroll Arts Center, 7:30 a.m., and we will have all 5 commissioners present for that.
Hey, I might come.
I hope. Wednesday, January the 11th, National Security Agency Tour, Fraser, Wentz, and Rothschild, 1 o'clock, the Carroll County Board of Education work session, Commissioner Howard, 4 o'clock, Carroll County Board of Education meeting, Commissioner Howard. And on Thursday, January 12th, Carroll County closed administrative session at 8:30, 10 o'clock, Board of Commissioners open session. We will be, Mike Fowler's retiring, yeah, it's BG&E, interesting. Exercise option to purchase an easement on Joseph Roberts and Deborah Roberts' property. We go into a briefing discussion, possible decision, Department of preliminary recommendation CIP and request bond authorization. Then we move into county financial position overlook, IRC, and let's see, Friday, January 14th, NAACP 14th Annual Martin Luther King Breakfast, Martin's Westminster, Commissioner Wance. And I'll probably be there also. And then Sunday, January 15th, we have Commissioner Howard, WTTR.
I think did I hear there might be some additional items for Thursday as well? Is anything coming back?
Yeah, one additional.
And a quick question while we're on this agenda. Did we put out a press release or whatever in reference to who's responsible for serving on the various boards, what have you? Yeah, us guys.
We put out a press release. We sent letters to all of you.
We should send out a
notice.
Yeah, but could we do that through the paper or press release? Who serves on what committees?
We did. They asked
the information. Okay. It was in the newspaper.
Oh, that was it?
Yeah.
Several weeks.
Yeah, that's off the District 1 for some reason.
That might have been one of those days I didn't get my Carroll County Times because it's pretty sporadic in District 1.
I don't feel bad. District 2 has its own issues. But anyway. And January 16th, officers.
Yeah, but the word gets back, you see. Just saying.
On January 16th, the county offices are closed in observance of Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Tuesday, January 17th, we have planning and zoning meeting, Commissioner Fraser at 9 a.m., and Veterans Council advisory meeting at 2 p.m. I'll be there. Wednesday, January 18th, BWI Partnership Signature Breakfast, Colonel Richard Lincoln Heights, Maryland, Reich Record, sorry, and that's Commissioner Howard. And then we have the Maryland Association of Counties Legislative Committee meeting, Commissioner Rothschild at 2:30.
And me.
And Commissioner Wance. And Wednesday, January 18th, Carroll County Community College Board meeting, Commissioner Wance, 3 o'clock. And 5:30, we have the Care First Commitment Legislative Reception in Annapolis, Commissioner Wance and Howard.
How are you going to be at the Carroll County?
I can do amazing things, Hoover.
In a half an hour?
Yeah, just watch me.
He has a speeding ticket to prove it.
Yeah, we're going to be that. Yeah, I'm not sure. Keep us listed there in case we do. I think that's always the better way to do it, right? That's err on the side of making sure we're all listed.
And then you're going back down to Annapolis.
It's possible, yeah. Yeah. Typically.
The legislative reception in Annapolis, is that the Care First one? Is there a different one?
The Care First one. There is a different one.
There's a different one.
That's not till the end of January, Rich.
The following week.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's on the 20th. Yeah, is it the 27th?
Said 23rd, 27th, 27th.
I mean, there's a bunch of them now. That's the thing. I've got three of them the week of the 23rd, but I don't know which is which.
Does Carroll County have theirs?
No, Carroll County doesn't have one. It's either Mako or.
But they did.
Used to.
For several years. Yeah. Yeah. The rural Maryland one is in that.
Yeah, I don't know what it is.
Okay. Thursday, January 19th, Board of Commissioners closed administrative session at 8:30. 10 o'clock, Board of Commissioners open session. We will have annual transportation plan presented, and then we will move ahead to public comment. We'll be taken during a public hearing, and this is personnel policies. And at 1:30, open session comes back and we joint Board of County Commissioners and Environmental Advisory Council meeting.
And that's in Reagan Room.
At the Reagan Room, okay, it's at 1:30. And on the Friday, January 20th, Carroll County State's Attorney Middle School Drug Program presentation, West Middle School, Commissioner Wance will be there. Saturday, January 21st, New Windsor Fire and Hose Company installation banquet. Commissioner Howard will be there. And Commissioner Rothschild. And Sunday, January 22nd, we have the WTTR report, Commissioner Wance. And we have an Eagle Scout Court of Honor ceremony, Sandy Mount Methodist Church, Commissioner Weaver.
The other four of you doing TTR reports? It seems like I do it almost every other week.
No, you're doing it every week.
You do one?
You're a rock star.
I'm trying to get out of it. I put your name in whatever.
Mine today or tomorrow. There's something going on. There's something going on.
Yeah. Okay.
It's Groundhog Day.
We are going from here back to, let's see, where are we going? We're doing here. Do I have any other thing, anything else for administrative session?
Do we have to close admin after this?
Yes.
Can we? I'm just signing. Can we? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Do I hear a motion? We adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. You vote?
No.
Okay. 3-1, and we're adjourned.
I thought I'd shake it up.
Carroll County Government now streams live right to your smartphone. Go to carrollcountymd.iqm2.com.